Hello world, today we'll take a look at smart pointers and we'll do a terrible thing, which is try to build our own smart pointers. We'll call them dumb pointers because they'll be terrible. But in the process maybe we'll learn some things about how smart pointers actually work. So in the standard library, we have four types of smart pointers. Outside of the standard library, you'll find many more, but we'll talk about these four today. Actually, we won't talk that much about AutoPointer. AutoPointer has the same idea behind it as unique pointer, but AutoPointer was created before C++11, so there was no move semantics. And this made the implementation be a little bit awkward by modern standards, so AutoPointer is deprecated. Yeah, so let's talk about unique pointer. By the way, all these smart pointers are in the memory header. Let's talk a little bit about the idea behind smart pointers. Why not just use irregular pointers? Okay, so here I very awkwardly used heap allocation, even though I don't have to, just to illustrate a point. This is a pretty contrived example, but here we see that we just printed the number 3, so everything's working correctly, but there's a memory leak, right? I'm using heap allocation, calling new, and for every new, there must be a delete. So that's a pretty easy rule to follow. And now, no memory leak. But what if this was a function? Still a pretty simple example, but what happens if this function here also calls another function and or creates a class and sends this pointer around? How can I be sure that this pointer doesn't get deleted along the way? If it gets deleted twice, it's a double delete. If it doesn't get deleted at all, it's a memory leak. So I have to be very sure that delete is only called once. And imagine maintaining this in a pretty big database. This is called a double delete. And hopefully your program crashes if this happens. But if you're unlucky, this can go unnoticed and then you have some problems. So there's a lot of bad things that can happen if you don't follow the rule one delete for every new. So what are we gonna do? We're gonna do a class to manage that. The idea behind unique pointer is that I get the pointer and then the ownership is with the unique pointer. So the unique pointer is the one responsible for deleting it. Yeah, so let's refactor our code to use a unique pointer. So here we already run into a problem. We need to pass a pointer to this function, but I only have a unique pointer. So let's do a way to get this pointer. Okay, now everything works. I'm just gonna move this function out of the way. Yeah, surprisingly, everything still works. This still has a lot of problems. The first one, my unique pointer only takes integers. What if I want the pointer to something else? Let's do a template. And our class works with any type. So what's this highlight here? The explicit keyword prevents the compiler from implicitly converting a pointer of type T to a unique pointer. Another problem here is that we're not following the rule of 5. We have written our own destructor, So we must write the other four special member functions. For now, I just defaulted everything, then we can think about it, but my IDE is already screaming at me because I forgot no except. Okay, let's think about what should happen in each case. What should happen when I make a copy? Since I defaulted the copy constructor, what will happen is every member will get copied. So this pointer will get copied, which means the pointer from J and the pointer from I will be both pointing at the same memory address. And what will happen when we get here and both get destructed? So there we have a double free again. And how does unique pointer get around this problem? Well, the name should give it away. You just cannot copy it, it's unique. So now we have the compiler telling us that we call the deleted constructor of unique pointer. That's the copy constructor. A double free again. So what will happen here is that by default the move constructor will move every member, and what happens when you move a pointer? It just copies the value of the address that the pointer is storing. And when we move I still points to the same address and will delete that address. So let's fix this. I prefer to initialize things where they're declared. That's a personal preference, and we can talk about this another day. Let's just do it here for now. So now J will get constructed with a new pointer value, and then I's value will get moved to it. And what we want to do is to put a new pointer into I. Since I is moved from, it doesn't concern us anymore, so we don't want it to delete anything. So when the destructor gets called, it will delete the new pointer, which just does nothing. And now, of course, everything broke. Let's see what happened. We're passing the pointer stored in I to the function. And then the function dereferences the pointer, but that's null pointer. So the code crashes. And now everything works again. So our move constructor is working. Now let's try to write a move assignment. And now again we have a double free for the same reason. Let's fix it. Well, and now our program works. And that's bad because we actually have a memory leak here. So when I build I, I'm putting a value of 3 into it. And when I build j, I'm putting a value of 42 into it. And when I move I into j, I'm getting that 3 and putting it into j and putting null pointer into I. So now j has the 3 and I has the null pointer. But who will delete 42? When j goes out of scope, it will delete the 3. And when I goes out of scope, it will delete the null pointer, which does nothing. So who will delete the 42? Well, since the variable I was moved from, it means we're not going to use it anymore. And the value 42 will also not get used anymore. So let's put them both together so that I deletes the 42 and we have no problem. So now we have no problem, I think. What we're doing here in those three lines is known as a swap. We're just storing the value of pointer temporarily because we're gonna overwrite it in line 24. And then in line 25, we're gonna use that temporary value. So we already have a function for this in the standard library, which is called the swap. And it works perfectly. Since we're using swap, let's also use swap in the move constructor. Yeah, great. And now we're not using delete anymore, but we're still using new. Let's write a function to abstract that for us. And now we have our make unique that will just take any arguments we give it and will call the constructor for us. Great. So here's my question for you. Why do we have a function for that? Why not just a constructor? Well, think about it, research it. We'll just stop this implementation here because it's perfect. And I mean perfect, but because it's a dumb pointer and it's pretty dumb. The standard library's unique pointer has many more features like release, reset, swap, conversion to bool, to check if the pointer that it's holding it's the new pointer or not. A custom deleter. And of course, automatic conversion in case of a class hierarchy. And tell me if you have any more things that our unique pointer doesn't do, but the standard library does. And for the next video, I have two ideas. We can try to make a dumb share pointer and a dumb weak pointer. Or we can try to use Google Test and Google Mock to test our unique pointer. What do you think? Which do you prefer? Leave a comment, please. Hello world, last week I posted my first video and I expected about 10 views and about 3 subscribers. We actually got over 100 views and over 10 subscribers, so I was very pleasantly surprised by that. Thanks everyone who watched and everyone who subscribed. This time we'll also be very modest. I'll be shooting for 100,000 likes. If I don't get it, I'll be very, very disappointed. I'm just kidding, guys. Thanks a lot. And bye, world.